Hi, everybody. I'm Rip Randall, and this is Rock and Roll High School.
Hey there, Jamie Brain.
Hi.
How you doing?
Oh, I'm doing this dandy.
That is mighty fine. Mighty, mighty fine. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the show. Yeah.
So it's Rock and Roll High School meets Cat's Pajamas.
That is correct. We met. Thank you for tuning in. See you later. Catch you next time. So we are meeting, and we're here to discuss music. And discuss many things. Here to pass the torch is what we're trying to do. That is our goal. That is what our the way that we're living our lifestyles, by passing music on to the next generation as it's been passed on to us.
Absolutely.
How has music been passed on to you, Jamie?
In the biggest way, through my siblings. My older brother, Eric, is 10 years older than me, and he let me tag along and learn about punk rock and skateboarding. And my big sister, Keisha, got me into new wave. And through my siblings, for sure.
Wow, some new wave. Uh-huh. Okay, new wave, punk rock, that's quite an interesting mix. But, you know, it's not too far off. I remember watching Pretty in Pink, or not Pretty in Pink, what's the one with Nicolas Cage, Valley Girl, right? And you got the new wave and you got punk rock in there, and it's a pretty cool mix up, for sure.
It's just the different generations of punk rockers, really.
That is
correct. Robert Smith and Susie hit the scene, everybody started doing a bunch of eyeliner and went weird clothes.
It did. It sounded really right, really right. Where do you think that stuff started from? Where's because we're talking about passing the torch, and then, you know, that's a different thing from what Iggy was doing, and then the rock and roll is even before that. I mean, that's pretty interesting.
Specifically, in around 1954, this would be when Elvis kind of took America by the pants and said, I'm here to take your children into the night. Here comes rock and roll, which in and of itself, I mean, it kick-started the civil rights movement. In a sense, for the first time, America was seeing a white person, in the South especially, where we're a little bit behind the times at this point in social history. You had Elvis singing black music, singing with this soulful presence and raunchy dance moves, you know, editing where he's only showing from the waist up because they just couldn't imagine. Oh my God. Never out of bed, hearts full of passion. Yeah, the parents were freaking out, of course. And, you know, rock and roll records being broken on air because how dare we subject our teenagers to know that, you know, you got to make change. And so it was the original punk rock movement is what it was. But it started out, if you want to call it rockabilly, it wasn't until the later years, but it's a mix of rhythm and blues, gospel and country music. And, you know, all those influences just meshed together. And then throughout the decades, you know, it just kind of got its own brand from that. The next generation, they put their spin on it. You know, like if you were to take bands like the Polecats, they kind of put like a new wave kind of fun spin on the rockabilly revival years. And just slowly, everyone just kind of threw their spice into the pot. And it changes every so often.
Yeah, it definitely did change. And you're correct. It did start with the end. It was a whole lot of craziness.
No, I will say, Elvis did not start it all.
Please. No, that is not what we're saying.
But when it was kickstarted, I just, for myself, I'm like, whoa, hold on. But, yeah, I would say that was when it really, rock and roll, it was around 54.
I would say
54.
Yes, and when you're speaking of Elvis and that whole movement, I think it wasn't per se the music that, right? It was more of the attitude, and that's where the punk rock really lies, is the attitude that they had. There's, you know, and you said gospel and everything. It's funny because Jerry Lee Lewis, who's definitely, you know, crazy attitude, he tried doing gospel music, and he was in church and he was performing in church, and I don't remember what song it was in particular. I'll fix that. But he was performing, you know, for the pastor at a church, if you will, and he was like, "All right, that sounds cool, but don't you think it sounded a little better like this?" And he started playing high notes, and he stood up, and the pastor literally slapped him upside the head. And that's when Jerry Lee was like, "You know what? Fuck you, I am out." And that was the punk rock attitude. I'm gonna do music my way, and that's it. That's so yeah. So going back to that, I would say that, yeah, it began with that attitude of, "Well, we're gonna do things this way, my way." And yeah, definitely. And then, you know, it broke off with the Ramones, who were doing stuff on their way, with CBGBs. And it was, again, no one wanted to hear it. So thank God for CBGBs for giving people a platform to be themselves and to be, fuck you, I'm doing this my way. Even though no other club at the time wanted to take these bands in, CBGBs was, yeah, hey, go for it. Come, you know, go nuts. So that is another torch being passed on from the 50s to, you know, going into the 60s with the Kinks and stuff, the 70s. And where else would you say the torch has been passed on?
Well, I'm kind of being taken aback just a little bit because I got to say one of my favorite punk rockers of the time, original times, Little Richard. Can we talk about that for a second? Who weren't even able to be in a town past a certain time, or they're literally risking their lives to play music. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, it is mind-blowing. It makes you realize how much sacrifice went into this music that they were creating, like literally risking themselves. People like Charlie Pride, who, yes, he's a country singer, but punk rock AF. Right. Charlie Pride would show up to honky-tonks in the South, and he, at this point, put a record out. The record label lightened his skin on the cover of the album. So the audience that was there to see him didn't even know that he was black. Wow. Until he walked out on stage. And
surprise, motherfucker.
He was singing country music. Like, these are to the good old boys, right, you know? Like, right. To me, that is so, I mean, literally. And he had such a great, just disarming, authentic charm to him that he would walk out, and he knew that it would be, I mean, he knew that it would be kind of strange, but he would just disarm them and say, look, my pigmentation is a little bit different than yours, but I'm here to sing you a song, and just jumped into it. And that right there, like, whoa.
Yeah. Definitely.
I mean, holy crap.
That is punk rock attitude.
It is. It totally is. The people like Wanda Jackson playing a gig, and they're setting up, and her band is getting warmed up for the show to come that night, and Big Al Downey is on stage, and the club owner comes over and says he can't be on stage. He's got to go out back. And wow. Wanda says, well, if he can't be here, I can't be here. Pack it up, boys. Right. Like, rad.
Yeah, definitely rad.
So it's standing up for people, too. It's just, it's so important, you know?
It is definitely important. We wouldn't have a lot of the stuff that we had without them. So going back to Elvis, you know, and Elvis did a lot of cover songs. And I know there's heat out there for, is he the king? And then we wouldn't be listening to many artists. Big Mama Thornton, you know, Nothing But a Hound Dog. Mm-hmm. The world wouldn't have that had Elvis had not get paid homage. And, you know, it was out of respect. There was much love and respect between both communities. So so for that, I do respect Elvis a whole lot. I love Elvis. And I wouldn't be listening to all these great artists if it wasn't for that. So, and that was very punk rock of him. He was dressing in a way that was not cool for a white
getting
guy.
Getting made fun of, right, for greasy hair, you know.
Right, right. That attitude was definitely punk rock. So yeah, definitely.
I interviewed Texas musician Sid King from Sid King and the Five Strings last summer, and he came up around the same time playing on the Big D Jamboree here in Dallas and would headline shows with Elvis, and later went on to record at Star Day with George Jones, etc. But he was telling me a story about the first time he met Elvis. And he said, man, Sid, he's like, I thought you was younger. He's like, but then again, people hear me on the radio and think that I'm black. So, you know, so he knew.
Right.
He knew that he was crossing over barriers that weren't the norm.
Right.
But I think coming from where he was, being from the South and growing up in the Southern Baptist, that he had that authenticity that skin color wasn't really an issue.
Right,
you know, it
right.
was just... It was music.
Right,
just
good music
roll
is
with
good
it.
Music, absolutely.
And somebody had to kind of take that first step to make it more tolerable for those who weren't quite ready for a big change. You know?
Yeah, and you passed
and
the torch. Yeah. Yeah, and so then fast forward to here, and here we are now talking about music and passing the torch, because a lot of people don't know these things, and... I was so ignorant to think that everyone knew everything that I knew about music, and so I would bring stuff up and people were like, what are you talking about? you know, and I, you know, paying respect to and giving credit to those before you, you know? You don't know where you're going unless you know where you've been, by Bob Marley. He says that quite often. And he's right in doing so, because you listen to the music back then, you hear the influences in the music, and it's just like a big old tree branch where you help me with this.
Yeah, I know. Understanding the roots of it really opens up your own. I mean, to me, when I started looking into the history and the roots of all this, I mean, it opened up all these other like subgenres and different avenues that the sound has taken over the years, and the people that were big influences in it, whether it be that they were creating, or they were an older generation artist, musician, etc., that took younger ones under their wing, therefore allowing like the next kind of kickstart, keeping the torch burning. There's so many different elements within all of it, and especially and on this wall, you'll see right behind me, Mr. Ronnie Dawson, the Blonde Bomber from Dallas. He was well known for this certain 90s, early 2000s, whole network of rockabilly roots musicians seeing the light in a lot of the younger musicians coming up, such as Nick Curran, such as Jimmy Sutton, and taking them like on their first European tours that literally kickstarted passing along the torch that they were doing it right. He saw the respect to the predecessors and would see a light in someone, take them under their wing, and it garnished like this whole network of they're doing the same thing. You know, they're passing along to the next generations, and it's called the School of Ronnie D, and the roots run real deep on that one. But it's appreciation for those also who do that, you know, that keep it going and keep it burning. That's so important.
Absolutely. Passing that torch and going back into the past. I was listening to Rock and Roll High School earlier, actually, and you played some James Brown, and I was thinking about...
James, get on up, bam, over here. Get on up, James, get on up, bam, get on up.
He's the godfather of funk, and the godfather of you know, of a lot of things, soul music, and then even tried being the godfather of disco. Didn't work out because he's not the godfather of disco, and you know, when he claimed this, it was actually the same year people were burning disco albums, literally getting their albums in disco. You know, it was the
not
end of disco.
Time. Not a hot time for disco, Mr. Brown.
And not a good time to claim to be the godfather of it.
Papa's got a brand new bag, but it better not have disco in it.
Not this one. So then it was 1980s when he just became the godfather of hip-hop, because a lot of musicians at the time were while DJs were looking through, it's called digging crates, and they were going through old records. And so they were doing, passing the torches being passed from their parents. Oh, I heard this. And now they're looking for break beats for certain drum beats within certain songs. And that's where James Brown came in and became the torch being passed on, where they're paying homage, acknowledging this music, breaking new ground, creating something else, something that was new. In passing the torch and going back and listening to the roots to get to where we're at now.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Definitely. And so that's what you're going to get here on this show. We were going to be talking about music history, many of music, whatever. What else would we be talking about here?
What would Joe Strummer do?
What would Joe Strummer
do?
What would he do?
He would incorporate heavy social messages mixed with fun, easygoing punk rock.
Move yourself to go again. Cold water in the face brings you back to this awful place. Knuckle merchants and your bankers too. Let's get up and learn those rules. Weatherman and the crazy chief. One says sun and one says sea. AM, the FM, the PM too. Turning out that boogaloo.
What would Patsy Cline do?
Patsy Cline would say, listen, Hoss, take life by the balls. That's what Patsy would do.
What would Nick Curran do?
Nick Curran would play rock and roll right up until the very end and would keep evolving creatively without any hindrance to style and authenticity. In fact, he would play a pink Kramer while on tour with the Fabulous Thunderbirds and cut his hair into a mohawk just to say, labels are dumb, this is me, you know?
Yeah, punk rock AF. To have to be yourself and feel free to be who you truly are and dig deep into your roots so you can know where you're going. And so we look forward to you tuning in and checking it out and sharing more stories with you. I am Cat's Pajamas and this is
Jamie Brains.
Oh, yowza.